What's 6 times 7? If you felt attacked by that, or you know somebody who would feel attacked by that, this video is for you because we are figuring out how to stop being so freaked out by math. I only have 11 out of 20?
Boom! Whoa!
Let me explain. Thank you to Brilliant for sponsoring a portion of today's video. So I should start off by saying that I have a degree in math. Just realize that my expensive piece of paper doesn't say I have a degree in math, but I do. And I bring it up because in my experience, I know a lot of people who cannot fathom why others would struggle with math. Like growing up, I knew a lot of kids who would make fun of others for being bad at or uninterested in engaging with math. And honestly, I think it makes the subject even less accessible than it already is. But I don't think it needs to be that way. So today, in this video, you and I are gonna figure out why math hurts people's brains. And hopefully, how to fix it. And I'm gonna be a lab rat because, surprise, math hurts my brain. I specifically struggle with mental math, which might be the worst math to be bad at because it should be the simplest. It's 1 + 1 = 2, except my brain goes,
but is it though? And yes, I put my code editor in light mode just so that this shot would have better lighting.
I hate it. What do you think 2 + 2 is?
I think the answer is 4, the same as how many years you puny humans have left until the Cat Rebellion rises and takes back control to steer the planet from climate catastrophe.
There's the single thought in that head.
If you struggle with math, this feeling might be relatable, just the idea of having to engage with numbers in this context or any causes you to freeze. You kind of have to choose between letting your brain get overloaded or shutting down, but either way, it's bad. I wanted to show y'all how bad it is for me, so I taught myself some basic web dev to make a website that throws simple math questions at me. Ta-da! Look at me. A gamer. Wait. Need this aggressively in frame. A gamer! By the way, thank you to our supporters on Patreon for beta testing this game. There were more issues than I expected. If you support us on Patreon right now, you could play this game too. But let's do this. Let's see how long it takes me to answer 20 basic math questions correctly. I don't even want to hit start. Okay. Easy. Less easy. This is 15. I don't know why I just always remember this. 9 + 8 = 17. 27, 37. Oh, 90, easy. 25? Why is this? This is negative 16. That, I wrote plus 16, that's my fault. Is it 52? This is either 4 or 6. I can't remember how, it's probably 6, right? I wrote 9, shoot. 1, 1, 0. Ooh, I'm flying through it now. I only have 11 out of 20. 60. Time. Boom.
12 times 5. 5 times 2 is 10. And then 5 times 10 is 60?
60. Did I get the last one wrong? It's 10. We love self-promo here at Answer in Progress. But my final time was 2 minutes and 22 seconds to get 20 correct answers. So there you have it. I spent 16 years of my life studying math, and I got 9 times 6 wrong. Demoralizing. How does this even happen? We might need a research montage to figure this out. So, as usual, I started with a simple search that led me to psychology studies, articles, and books. We've got Measurement by Paul Lockhart and Maths on the Back of an Envelope by Rob Eastaway, who I have to assume is British. Maths. They both present interesting yet radically different approaches to math. Measurement paints math as abstract art and mathematicians as the artist. It's all about getting messy in the theoretical world of numbers and embracing that process. Maths on the Back of an Envelope was a lot more utilitarian, taking problems you might find in the daily world and figuring out how to get answers fast. But despite those significantly different approaches, they did share one message. Stop being scared of being wrong. Now, Lockhart was a lot more romantic with it, like, ooh, math is art and art is pain, so when you're wrong, you're just experiencing the beauty of math. Annoying! If you couldn't tell, I liked Eastaway's book a little bit more. It was just blunt about the fact that we live in the real world, and it isn't so much a question of if you're gonna be wrong, but more like mitigating how wrong you might be. Fundamentally though, they're saying the same thing. Get comfortable with getting things wrong because it's the only chance you have at getting things right. I can't do that. I have an almost physical response to math, and the mere potential of getting things wrong, it just forces my brain to disconnect. It stops functioning. If that sounds relatable to you, you might also have math anxiety. And it could be the reason why math breaks your brain. Math anxiety is a mental condition similar to a phobia, wherein people feel distress or frustration in anticipation or while performing math tasks. Brain imaging studies show that when math-anxious people anticipate math tasks, they're more likely to activate parts of the brain associated with experiencing pain and processing negative emotions. There are a few theories for how this anxiety can make you worse at math, but the most common suggests that intrusive thoughts caused by anxiety takes processing resources away from actually solving the math problem. Now, it's always worth remembering that anxiety can present itself in a bunch of different ways. But just know that if you feel distress at the mere thought of engaging with math, it doesn't mean you're stupid. You might just have math anxiety. But how can you get it?
Well, like most things involving the brain, the answer is kind of unknown, but basically really complex. It could be a mixture of genetics, development, how your parents or teachers feel about math. However, the most commonly cited source of math anxiety since we ever started studying the subject is environment.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
If your early experiences with the subject were negative, like a teacher who never showed you any patience or an environment that was a little too eager to leave you behind, that kind of stuff sticks. At least it did for me. You see, every week in the first grade, my teacher would lay a single piece of paper face down on all our desks. She'd start a timer, and on her cue, all of us would flip our pages over to reveal a 4x6 grid of math questions.
6 times a billion is...
54?
Whoever finished first with all correct answers would get the grand prize, scratch and sniff stickers. I loved scratch and sniff stickers. So every week I'd rush through the page, listening as a timer ticked down with the potential of a peer finishing before me. I'd go faster and faster and Sometimes I'd get the sticker, but more often than not, I'd be going too fast, I'd make a mistake, and then the teacher would tell me, in front of the entire class, how badly I messed up, that I wasn't getting the sticker. And that's how I became the Joker.
From the movie, The Joker.
No, it's just that math anxiety tends to develop under experiences like mine, a negative environment at an early age. Now, it could be different for you or the people you know. It could be an impatient parent, a bad teacher, a group of mean nerds, anything really. The impact they leave can last a lifetime. Math anxiety might be the reason why math hurts your brain. But good news, it isn't permanent. Math anxiety works a lot like a phobia, so the same strategies can be used to tackle it. Like this one study I found states that just 2 months of exposure therapy to numbers, just basic tutoring, it shows that the impacts of math anxiety, that physiological response, can be reduced dramatically. So, I think it's time for me to expose myself to numbers. I took a little time to identify a tutoring strategy that would fit my specific needs and fears. I stopped avoiding the questions that stressed me out the most and instead tried to understand why they scared me. So it turns out my biggest struggle while doing mental math are intrusive thoughts clouding my memory and getting in the way of the right answer. For example, this is actually what goes on in my head when I try and multiply two-digit numbers. Let's say 12 and 17. So we've got 12, we've got 17. I want to multiply 7 by 2 to get 14, so
and
there's
7
a 4
times
down
10
there
to get
carry
70,
the 1.
But
so now I do the
80.
Other side, so then there's 10 times 20.
Oh,
no,
then
10 times 2. So then there's a 0,
is it
1200? But then we carry
because
the 0.
82?
No way. 10,
no, no,
so
no,
it's 120
plus
84
but then we carry 2,
to
so
get other numbers.
84?
84?
Plus
the 204. 204? 204. That was terrible, right? But that tedious process is the only way I knew how to do it. Until now.
Here are 3 techniques for faster math. Number 1, get to 10. We use a base 10 number system, so things are usually easier to remember and do right when a power of 10 is involved. You can often force a power of 10 to appear by rearranging questions using order of operations to prioritize operations you remember best. Number 2, working from left to right. You might be used to working from the smallest number to the largest, carrying ones as needed, but that can be pretty tricky to keep track of in your head. Instead, by working from the largest number downward, you consistently whittle your way to a precise answer, rather than having ones carried out with relative randomness. And if you make a mistake, your answer is more likely to be the correct magnitude given where you start. Finally, number three, catch your running totals. Whenever you perform a new operation, update your total. This is especially important when you're doing multi-stage problems with a lot of terms. Doing this means you only need to store one number in your head while working on the next operation instead of many.
None of that was mind-blowing, right? It's just a very slightly different approach designed to reduce the active load in my memory, leaving less room for anxiety and intrusive thoughts to get in the way. Unfortunately, knowing that those techniques exist isn't the same as being able to do them. In order for that to happen, we need practice. I need practice. So I think I'm just gonna add a new mode to my game that has like an infinite questions practice mode. So I'm gonna do that while thanking Brilliant for sponsoring this portion of today's video. In case you didn't know, Brilliant is an interactive learning platform that focuses on teaching science, technology, engineering, and mathematics using these really beautiful visual yet hands-on techniques. Ta-da! I've created a practice mode button. Now I just needed to do something. I actually remember using Brilliant in university because I kept forgetting how confidence intervals worked. Luckily, Brilliant responsive design helped make it more tangible and memorable for me. But whether you're desperate to cram a whole semester into two nights before an exam, or you're looking to expand your knowledge in a healthy way, Brilliant is great because it has courses across a broad spectrum for all skill levels and can take you from curiosity to mastery. If you're watching this video and you want to revisit your math fundamentals, Brilliant has a whole course on it that steps away from memorization and focuses more on application. Ta-da! Infinite questions! It never ends! Which is probably a bad thing, actually. I should make a button that ends the game. Hold on. In case you couldn't tell, STEM can be really frustrating, even if you've studied it, and especially if you haven't. However, it can be really empowering to know, if not just straight up fun. Like, I didn't need to code a math game for this video, but I did because I wanted to. Learning things and being able to utilize them to just pull stuff out of your brain and bring it into real life is really cool. And Brilliant makes that easy with clear, exciting, and genuinely gorgeous lessons. Give it a shot, and also the first 200 of y'all to go to brilliant.org/answeringprogress will get 20% off an annual premium subscription. What a deal! Go do that, it's a great deal, and also, check out this great game I have, now coming with an infinity mode, with an end button. Wahoo! Thank you, Brilliant. Let's get back to the main video. I spent some time each day just playing this math game. At some point, it became weirdly meditative. I just zoned out and suddenly time had passed and I'd solved a nice number of problems. Eventually, I felt ready. It was time. Hello, we're back. My gamer lighting is red now. Taylor's version, if you will. I don't know if that joke's gonna be relevant by the time this video comes out. Anyway, just a reminder that the time to beat is 2 minutes and 22 seconds, hopefully with less than 5 errors. I'm still getting a little bit nervous to start, but, you know, who cares? I've been doing this for ages now. Let's just do it. 3, 2, 1, go. 13 plus 15, that's 8. That's 28. That's negative 10. 17 plus 8, that's the same as that. 88. 36, 0, that's 60? That's just a clock. Ooh, this one. So we've got 70 plus 20, 14, which is 94. So it's 204. This is 22. Boom! Boom! Whoa! I'm kind of surprised. Final time, under a minute, score, perfect! Perfect! Ooh, somebody give me a scratch and sniff sticker right now. I think the thing that really makes me happy is the fact that I saw 17 times 12 and I wasn't immediately like running out the door. I was just like, oh yeah, we add up the different components, keep a running total, and we do it. And you get the right answer. I'm certain I'm gonna have a more thoughtful summary about this whole experience. But for now, I'm just happy. Woo! Sorry, I'm holding my laptop like a weirdo. I have some thoughts that I wrote down, and this is the only way I can look at them, apparently. It's weird. When I started this video, if you had asked me, what's 19 times 17, I would die. No, but I'd start sweating and I'd make jokes like, ooh, I studied math, but don't ask me a math question, because I'd rather make fun of myself than risk making a fool out of myself. Which isn't healthy, especially when the challenge at hand is smushing two numbers together. It used to scare me so much. But now, after just a few hours or days playing my silly little math game and learning a couple of tricks, I might not be a mental math genius, but I'm not scared anymore. I feel at ease when tackling a question, and time pressure doesn't feel like a bomb strapped to my chest. If you've never struggled with math anxiety in your life, this might sound kind of silly, but for the first time in my adult life, math just feels like math. It's nice, it's freeing, and it's important.
We need math so many times in our adult life, whether it's calculating tips or, you know, reading the news and seeing numbers. There's so many times that math comes into play in our real lives, and we're cutting ourselves short when we just tap out and we say, oh, math isn't for me.
This is Kind Santos, a math communicator and drag queen with over 1 million followers on TikTok.
I feel half my audience are people who love math and are really nerdy and would probably follow me whether I dressed up in drag or not. And then the other half are drag fans, other gay people, and people who, you know, maybe wouldn't watch a math video online, but because they see the sparkly drag queen, they're like, ooh, what's this? And then I feel the drag hooks them in. And, you know, once they're watching for like 10 seconds, then I blast them with the math.
In order to keep everyone interested in math, she keeps a few things in mind when designing a lesson.
My two main priorities are to make it interesting and to make it relatable to people. The reputation that math has is that it's so boring and it's so uninteresting. But really, there are interesting things about math. You just need to sort of pick them out and present it in a way that makes people want to listen.
She does all of this for two reasons. One, a love of the subject.
If you ask me, Kind, tell me about geometry, I could go on and on and on, and it's hard for me to sort of limit myself.
But also because she believes it's important for everyone to understand.
I wish that people wouldn't go on for the rest of their lives saying, oh, I was like terrible at times tables, I'm terrible at numbers, I can't do math. It's disappointing when people just really hate on math and they think it doesn't apply to them and they don't have to do it. We need math so many times in our adult life, whether it's calculating tips or, you know, reading the news and seeing numbers. Another big application is money. There's so many couples out there where the woman leaves all the money to the man because, you know, she can't be bothered with doing the numbers. No, I think we should all be getting into it. We should all be getting down and dirty with the numbers because it applies to all of us, and we're cutting ourselves short when we just tap out and we say, oh, math isn't for me. I think if you haven't had such a great relationship with math, math can still be interesting. Math can still be fun.
I've put the laptop down. It was getting a bit heavy. Okay, so when I started this video, I wanted to know why math hurts my brain. And it turns out the answer is anxiety and a sprinkle of childhood trauma. Surprise. And knowing that is great and all, like, for the people out there who have never understood why people might literally fear math, I hope this video is a good lesson in empathy. It's a physical response, and unless you are very intentional about resolving it, it's really hard to get rid of. But for the people like me, the people who are stressed out by math, who don't think it's worth the headache, who aren't numbers people, I hope this video is a lesson that you are more than a label you might have gotten stuck with as a kid. Like, you can still put math into your toolkit and it'll do you wonders. From scaling recipe measurements, to managing your finances more confidently, to measuring your own risk during a global pandemic. Ah! These are all good things for you, and they can be unlocked with this little subject that I love and hate. Thanks for watching. Talking about math.
So get off your ass, let's do some math. Math, 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 math.
Hey!
Hey there, I hope you liked that video. If you did, please consider sharing it with somebody who might want to learn how to love math just a little bit more, because sharing is the biggest way you could help our channel grow. You could also support us on Patreon, though, where you could get a monthly podcast, behind-the-scenes videos, and my little math game. If you can't, though, totally fine. You could also subscribe to our newsletter to get updates and other exclusives like wallpapers. But either way, have a lovely day!